Thank you very much, and thank you very much for this invitation and giving me the opportunity to speak here today. So it's a bit unhandy title. It's thoughts and facts on bibliometric indicators in the light of new challenges in their applications. This is not so very much specific. I will not bore you with particular indicators and how to calculate that. It is more a conceptual presentation. This is the structure of the presentation actually. And I will also, of course, summarize the don'ts and the do's and individual level bibliometrics as announced right now, but it will also be a bit more, and I have also to go back to the roots of bibliometrics to explain and to make it possible to understand what the current trends in bibliometrics are, and what the pitfalls, the caveats are, and also the things we have to take into account whenever we apply bibliometrics. So I start with an introduction, so, and this is also the structure of this presentation. You know, bibliometrics is about 50 years old and started actually in the US about 1960 by launching the first citation index, and that made it possible to apply citation analysis, but also other sophisticated applications of bibliometrics. But first I would like to have a look at the so-called, I call it perspective shift that took place in bibliometrics during the last 40 years, and that resulted in a lot of issues we are faced with today, a lot of uninformed use and misuse even of bibliometrics. And this found an expression also in some new initiatives, like for instance the Doha Declaration, you might have heard of that, or the so-called Leiden Manifesto that has been issued 2 years ago, or 1 year ago. I will also discuss that briefly. The second issue refers to the focus shift away from the formerly applied macro studies down to more meso and micro studies down to the individual level of individual authors and scientists. And then I will also tell you something about something that is related to the methodology behind these applications I mentioned, namely associated with meaningfulness, the validity and robustness of indicators, and also the replicability of results. And finally, if there is still some time left, I would also like to introduce some new trends in bibliometrics, some new challenges that are linked to new applications and fields of applications of bibliometrics, like application to social sciences, the humanities, and also the web, including social networks, and also new applications where bibliometrics can play a certain part. For instance, already mentioned in the previous presentation, societal impact, for instance, impact beyond the scientific or academic communities. Okay, as to the bibliometric background, in order to be able to understand what happened in bibliometrics during the last 40 years, we have to go back to the roots. And actually, bibliometrics is very closely linked to the phenomenon of the process of the evolution from little science to big science. That process has been described by the Seller Prize in his famous book published in 1963. The title was Little Science, Big Science and Beyond. And this is the beginning of the big science is actually marked by the Manhattan Project. So that was the time when we can consider science becoming a big science. And of course, the effect of this process was the increase of scientific research and of funding and literature, and this led actually to the development of a quantitative measurement of research output and performance. But in the beginning, of course, bibliometrics was still a service activity in the framework of scientific information. And one of the main objectives in the beginning was describing, modeling, and monitoring the process of knowledge production, there's a dissemination and use of information. And that changed in the 70s, 80s, but before I just wanted to say that the first means, the first tools developed in bibliometrics, they're still in the service of this kind of scientific information and information services in more generally speaking. And practically the first applications were very closely linked to the first citation databases launched by the Institute for Scientific Information in Philadelphia, the ISI. The owner and director was Gene Garfield, and he and Scheer developed the impact factor, and the impact factor, you know, that is a matter that is very much under dispute, and even the Doha Declaration is a warning of using this impact factor, but in the beginning the impact factor was just, oh, what's that? Okay, developed as a tool to identify new journals for the citation database. It was quite naturally, if it is a citation database, you should use citations to identify journals that are relevant candidates to be covered by the database. And of course, Garfield himself recognized the power of the impact factor also as a evaluation of a in research evaluation as a measure of journal performance, but just journal performance. And also this second tool developed by ISI, it was the so-called Atlas of Science that was being issued already in the 70s, was considered just an extension towards review literature. It was not associated with evaluation at all. And also Garfield was convinced it would be quite useful in helping students in the choice of their career in science. So that's a bit the background that you see, just to illustrate that bibliometrics was very much in the service of information services and scientific information. But of course, with the growth of knowledge and the evolution from little science to big science, also there was a growing run and competition for funding, and the traditional kind of research evaluation by peer reviews, expert opinion, was not sufficient and efficient anymore, notably at higher levels of aggregation like institutional and national level. So also bibliometrics found entrance into this kind of application. And actually in the 60s and 70s there was in, or started in the so-called science indicators movement in the US, you know, in the 60s science, there was the race for the moon, there was a Cold War with all the strategic goals of scientific search, notably in the sciences, in the hard sciences. And it was also the time for big investment in scientific research, but there was kind of lacking transparency, and people simply wanted to know what happens with the tax money spent for scientific research. And that led finally to the science indicator movement, where the National Science Report had been published in the 70s. This marked the change from use of bibliometrics in the framework of information science towards research evaluation and science policy. And I called this a perspective in bibliometrics, and this of course resulted also in a reinterpretation of the bibliometric conception and tool. As a consequence, many of the tools that have been developed for the application in information services were not fit for the new kind of application in research, evaluation, and science policy. For instance, the impact factor is a typical example for that, and that is also an origin of a lot of misapplications, misuse of bibliometric tools, or at least uninformed use of bibliometric tools, as we witness today. I will come to that a bit later, more in detail. But of course, I told you that bibliometrics was embedded in information science, but there is a second basic thought that sociology of science that paved the way, the methodological way for all the applications in research evaluation policy. So, and of course there is also a technical aspect of this change, that the breathtaking development of ICT development, because when I started up my career in bibliometrics, it was actually in 1980, I still used the print version of the SCI, Science Citation Index, for my first studies. Later on we have licensed the tape version, but nowadays everybody, almost everybody, has access to databases, or at least to the web with Google Scholar, and can do some bibliometric work without having any knowledge about the methodological background of this field. In the beginning still, when we licensed the magnetic tapes from ISI in Philadelphia, it was also the case there were only a couple of institutions worldwide that had the knowledge and the software, also the methodology to calculate, to build indicators, to apply them and to perform, or to perform studies. Okay, and that's the reason why bibliometric methodology could not always keep pace with the demands of the breathtaking development in data processing. And I use this, it's sorry for this picture, for this graph, it's already 15 years old or something like that, but I think it's still, it can be used. It's just to illustrate what happened in bibliometrics. So on one hand we have information science as the background of bibliometrics, then later on we have sociology of science and research evaluation and science policy. You see it here on the, I think that's here. Okay, and I just use the citation. You know that the notion of citation in information science is the use of scientific information and unformalized use of scientific information in the within the framework of documented scholarly communication. But sociology of science, I just mentioned Robert Merton, who said that citation is part of a reward system. And the reward system is very much associated with quality, and practically in science policy, citation is considered a quality measure. I do not agree with that, because primarily citations are not quality measures. Oppenheimer has shown that there is some correlation between quality, other quality measures and citation, but it is primarily not a quality measure, I have to stress that. So if you look at interpretation in terms of information science, so what happens? Unsightedness does just mean unused information, not more nor less. There might be different reasons. Of course, for instance, research might be ahead of time, or by any reason the results not cited are not yet recognized by the community. Or it, results might have been published in obscure journals, for instance, or just in results are not relevant. A frequent citation is a sign of good reception, and self-citations are just part of scientific communication, because if I have a project, I publish a paper, have some follow-ups, of course I cite myself. I use previous information of my own work, and along with work information published in work of others, and cited. But in science policy nowadays, very often unsightedness is associated with low quality, with lacking reward. Frequently cited as high quality and self-citation as a distortion of impact, sometimes as a manipulation of impact. So I had I read an article in Dutch in Flanders that appeared about 3 or 4 years ago, and it was entitled "Self-citation is just blowing your own trumpet." So I was protesting. So it is not, it could not be the consequence to ask or demand from authors not to cite themselves. So this is the other extreme. So of course, in exaggerated extent of self-citation is harmful, that's for clear. But not citing yourself, what does it mean? Don't you trust you in your own results? So yeah, everything has to be put into perspective, of course. But I just wanted to illustrate how the two perspectives have a different, or result in different interpretation of the same phenomenon. So, some further consequences of the perspective shift, and now we come to the challenge, that's the second chapter, so to speak, of meso and micro bibliometrics, is that we have to apply appropriate methods and different methods to different levels of aggregation. So we have, of course, just to give you an example again, starting with the services in information seeking and information scientific information, and when I started my career in Budapest in the 80s, we had also provided the services what called ASCA services. That was a weekly alerting service based on the SCI database. We also used bibliometric tools like information links, citation links, sorry, like related records, for instance. It was really bibliometrics in the service of information services. So we compiled lists of relevant literature, what could be subscribed by scientists, and when we compiled a list of relevant literature, so it might happen that the list was not complete, or we had, out of maybe 100 items, we had 5 false positives. It was useful anyway, because the user was a competent person who could simply sort out these relevant results. But if we apply the same list in terms of research evaluation, which is incomplete and contains false positives, it is a mess. So you, that might just illustrate that at this low level of application of bibliometrics requires a high accuracy and certainly a different methodology than it is applied to the macro, to the national levels, where we have some higher tolerance for errors, maybe. Okay? So that means we need a high quality of data as well. Everything has to be clean and a watertight methodology. And Hengut actually raised the question of errors in this context in terms of an error rate in the assessment process. So, and there's another issue if it comes to the evaluation at the lowest level of the level of the level of individual scientists, that while bibliometrics at macro and meso level still preserves a certain extent of anonymity. So we know that, for instance, the emerging economies are producing in growing number of publications, but they are aware of that, of the fact that many of their publications are not yet representing the standard, the international standard. And they know that, and if we show that by means of bibliometrics, it's okay. But if we address it to individuals, say, yeah, your papers are not representing the standard in your field, that's an issue. So we have to be very careful with that. And that also means that there are some repercussions of the on the scientist publication and citation behavior that can already be observed in terms of how they change their publication behavior, how they publish this salami policy was already mentioned also. There are some rumors of creating citation clicks, so to speak, or increasing self-citations or things like that. It's not proven, but there are rumors in this direction. And that's the case because researchers have become more susceptible for the consequences of the use of bibliometrics. Again, I have kind of very simple figure. So it starts with the scientific community, with their publication, particular publication and citation behavior. There's just one point I wanted to mention. Again, with the changing publication behavior in the humanities, you know that instead of journal literature, more monographs and books are used in engineering, more conference contributions. And in the humanities, there is an increase, we observe an increase of publishing in journals, and in some fields, books are already considered job killers if you mention books in your CV. So that's something that is also due to the application of bibliometrics. So they have their specific publication and citation behavior. We know in mathematics, engineering, scientists are publishing less papers than in medical sciences and physics, for instance. And they also apply different, they have different citation behavior. So this is measured by bibliometrics and is like that. And bibliometric or cytometric reports and studies are commissioned or performed for use in science policy and research management. And of course, this is applied to funding and promotion, for instance, of individual scientists, or for grant funding, for instance, or other kind of funding. Even university block funding is using already bibliometrics. And of course, it comes back to the community, because scientists feel if they have been promoted or they feel lacking funding and whatsoever, and it happens that they think that it's a direct effect of bibliometrics. We do not understand the circle here, because also science policy and research management is sometimes, how can I say, has some demands concerning bibliometrics, what they would like to see. So this is a complete circle, but scientists a bit associate the outcomes of this step here directly with bibliometrics. And this results in change of the behavior. So, what are the specific requirements of micro-level bibliometrics? So we had a special, it was not a virtual, but a special session at the ISSI conference in Vienna in 2013, jointly with CWTS, with Paul Waters, and we have formulated, just for a while, 20 recommendations for bibliometrics. And we were concerned about uninformed use, the misuse, the misunderstanding sometimes of bibliometric methods at this level, because sometimes researchers feel even victims of the evaluations and bibliometrics. And first we have to say that the general rule that we have practically two traditional measures in research evaluation. One is based on peer review and expert opinion that symbolized by the blue pyramid. The green one is bibliometric cytometrics, and you see at the micro level you have no other choice. You have to use bibliometrics, you cannot you can only do very few things with expert opinion. And you see as the level decreases, the part or the role of bibliometrics also decreases, and the part of subjective evaluation increases at the individual level. You should more rely on expert opinion than on bibliometrics. But of course, we have heard also peer review has limits and it's highly subjective and sometimes biased as well. But the combination of the two is required at any level, notably at the lower levels, but also at the middle level, where you can nicely use both side to side, okay? What are the things you must not do at the individual level? We have formulated 10. Why 10? Yeah, just 10, it's good, because we have 10 recommendations. I would like to explain that a bit. The first one is don't reduce individual performance to single numbers. That's very, very important. With all the consequences, do not rank scientists based on bibliometrics. Do not use impact factors as measures of quality. That has been discussed at length, Dürer Declaration, Leiden Manifesto, all the other things, that it's a trend, a lot of literature, because impact factor has quasi become the hard currency of science, and that's not good. That's not good. It should not be applied in quality matter for individuals. Don't apply hidden bibliometric filters for selection. That's also something very often we see. Only report, when you report your research results, your publications, only report your publications that are published in journals with an impact factor higher than 1.5 or something like that. So that's a typical bibliometric filter. Or similar things. Don't apply arbitrary weights to co-authorship. So this is also a new trend. We have published a paper on that. Science and Nature is introducing, others are following already. Authors have to express their contribution to the paper, what was their role in preparing the publication. So That's very important, but only authors exactly know what their role and part was. So do not use things like saying, okay, yeah, first authorship counts one half, second authorship like that. So this is arbitrary, and you still have fields like mathematics or high energy physics where an alphabetic order is used. So, and in some, it's not due to fields, it's also practiced by faculties, departments, or so that the professor is always the last author of all publications of his or her PhD students. It's also questionable practice, but you see that weights of all authorship should not be determined by bibliometricians, but by the authors themselves, who are the only persons who know their contribution. Don't rank scientists according to one indicator. I mentioned it already in the first point, but this is also against ranking. Of course, you can make a certain ranking based on bibliometry as one of the viewpoints. You can short this, of course, saying, but it should not be the final decision. So you should not rank scientists according to one indicator. You need more aspects. Even if you apply bibliometrics, you should combine them, bundle them. Don't merge incommensurable measures. This also occurs sometimes. You take indicators from different sources. For instance, I see sometimes publication lists with citation rates indicated. Some are from Web of Science, some are from Scopus, some are from Scopus, some from Google Scholars. In the same list. Then you cannot combine them. Don't use flawed statistics. I've seen many odd indicators calculated by so-called semi-professionals, and there is no real background normalization by medians whatsoever. So be very careful with that, notably at this low level of aggregation. And do not trust in one-hit wonders. So very often I see that scientists have one top paper and they are saying, this is my paper, so this is what I have achieved. That's true, but this is only one-hit wonders if this is not supported by other research. So I am more confident if I see a CV with very good results, consistently very good results over a long period, than just seeing one times on top and then disappearing. Don't compare apples with oranges. That's always true, even if at the middle level. For instance, you should not compare a business school with a medical school. That's speaking for itself. And the same applies here. You should not compare a mathematician with a sociologist, for instance. Okay. And this is one point that's very serious. Don't lower deadlines and workload to compel you to drop good practices. So sometimes you are asked it, please provide, just give me one number. Because people know that's not sufficient, but they have to make their decision and they are working under pressures. And they are not able to support this by peer review because of lacking time. So don't don't accept this behavior, don't contribute to such manner of work. Okay. But it's contrasted by 10 do's. Yeah? You can also do something with bibliometrics at that level. You have to keep in mind that also at that level bibliometric is statistics. So don't provide indicators if somebody has only 3-4 publications. Then your recommendation should be, do not calculate indicators, just read these 4 papers. Okay? That's a better decision. You should also analyze collaboration profiles of researchers. Sometimes a researcher has good statistics, high citation rates, even high age indices, but this is all associated to research of others in collaboration. I have some very good examples for that. Young scientists who have achieved a lot, received a lot of citations, but it's actually due to their senior researchers, because they always appear as junior collaborators in their papers. Always combine quantitative and qualitative methods. Please keep in mind this two pyramids. And this is very important. At this level, you can have a look at the view citation context analysis. Not just count citations, look at the context. Are the results really incorporated into the body of knowledge of the field? Is other research built on the results of the research, or is it just mentioned in passing, okay, the interested reader might also refer to these papers, or even worse, it's all this kind of criticism. So you have the opportunity at this level to do so. Analyze subject profiles, very important. So they are not only interdisciplinary, multidisciplinary authors, they are also, polydisciplinary authors. One of the best examples might be Tibor Brown. Huh? He is still active as a chemist, but he is also active in cytometrics. And if you assign all his chemistry papers to cytometrics and vice versa, so that's not correct, that's not fair. Make an explicit choice for oeuvre or time window analyze. That's important. For instance, what the objective of the exercise? Would you like to apply bibliometrics at the individual level for a kind of benchmarking or for a warning, for instance, or for a promotion? For a doctorate, you probably need 5 to 10 years for a reward, maybe the life work of a scientist. For a benchmark, maybe just 3 years. So this all requires different methodology, and you should not mix it up. For instance, an age index might be a bit a good supportive tool for an award, for instance, but probably not for a benchmark. Combine bibliometrics with carrier analysis. This is very closely related to that. So it's, you have to also to look at which stage you are in the scientist's life, in the scientist's career. And that's very important, clean bibliographic data, carefully use external sources. So for instance, do not just trust on Google Scholar or on Web of Science, or do not just search in Scopus. Use publication lists provided by the institute, by the researchers themselves, their CVs, for instance, because that's the most reliable. So they know what their publications are. And you have to clean the data carefully. If you miss one highly cited paper in your evaluation, it's a mess, for instance. Or if you have a false positive, it's a highly cited one, then yeah, this researcher might not deserve this. The accuracy has to be extremely high at that level. Finally, even some don'ts are not taboo if properly applied. You might even apply the anti-factor age index if it is done wisely. For instance, if you say you have two researchers with two different age indices, and you say, okay, the extremely high age index of this researcher is in line with the otherwise positive picture we already have. It is just confirming it. Fine, why not? If you say, okay, on the basis of the impact factor of the journals where this scientist published, indicates that he is almost always publishing in high impact factor journals, why not? But do not make the decision, take the decision on the basis of impact factors of age. And do not say, okay, I support this researcher because his or her age is higher than that of all the competitors. Yeah? Do not do that. Okay, so that means do not condemn impact factors, age index, and everything completely. Apply them wisely. And finally, do not just provide numbers. Help users to interpret and to apply your results. Explain how to use them. And also explain them where the limitations of this kind of analysis is. Okay. Now, the next chapter, it's actually, we are coming now to deterministic probabilistic approach. I mentioned already, bibliometric statistics, even at the lowest level of aggregation. So, application of mathematics is very important then, and notably of probability theory in mathematical statistics, because you have a cytometric interpretation of your indicators. But apart from this, we have also mathematical interpretation. So it is a statistic, it has a statistic interpretation. Each mean, percentage, share, whatsoever ratio might have an interpretation. And on the basis of this interpretation, you can also conclude on limitations. For instance, for statistics, you can say about 30 is the lower limit. Above 30, you can apply mathematical statistics. Below, it becomes critical, and you should not do that. Okay? That's a very simple conclusion. And this also shows you have heard of so-called composite indicators, so people are combining indicators by using linear combinations, for instance. So this makes it all problematic because each component has an own error, and most components are not quite independent of each other, and if you combine them, you lose the control of the tolerance, the confidence intervals of the complex, the composite indicators. It's very highly problematic. We have published on that, so be careful with combining indicators. And there are, of course, also things, a variety of influences that are partially not directly measurable. So the complexity of social interactions itself yields the fact that it's usually interpreted as randomness. So even if you say many things in social life are not random, you are surprised how random these are. The fact that I'm sitting here today is a chain of a lot of random events. Even that I'm in Bibliometrics, if I tell you the whole story, that I'm in Leuven, it was a decision of a fraction of seconds, so to speak. Everything is due to randomness. But of course, also, there are kind of determination as well. It's a combination. And you have to take into account that communication, mobility, collaboration, publication, and citations are all subject of these effects. Okay. As to the statistic nature of bibliometric indicators, you can derive a lot of statistics from stochastic processes and from distributions. So we have heard about the skewness of citation distributions. So if you calculate indicators like shares, like averages or mean values or medians, this is all results in loss of information, of course. So if you have the complete distribution, you have still more information. That also means that you need more parameters to describe processes in scientific communication, more than just one. If you have just one parameter, you can express everything by one indicator. It would be fine, of course, but it is not the case. And there is, very early in the 70s, there was a nice paper by Dix and Chan, where they already introduced stochastic processes into bibliometry. They used actually a Poisson process for doing so. Yeah, that depends just on one parameter. It's actually more complex, and we have more complex models by now. One has been published by Quentin Berger in 2005, for instance. That's one of the best description of that. But there are also some or things in bibliometrics. Buchstein has described it in 97 when he distinguished three demons to measurement, causing uncertainty in social sciences. One is randomness. I was speaking about that. That can be coped with by using stochastic methods, but there are still two other things, is fuzziness, he called fuzziness and ambiguity. So you have to keep this in mind when you apply mathematics to social processes, always. And there are some pitfalls and caveats I have to point to. Is on one hand, one has to distinguish between samples in general and random samples in particular. For instance, the publication output of a university, Complutense University, is not a random sample, but it's a sample. It's a biased sample, probably, and you can show that if you compare it to the national standard, for instance. And sometimes, if you conclude, and this is also something that I find quite important, it's more important to know if something is not significantly deviating from something else, then it might be significant. For instance, if you rank papers or journals by impact factor, so sometimes it's good to know that, yeah, the deviation of the impact factor of two journals is not significant. So you can consider them a tie. It's important if you see always the self, it's quite a marketing strategy if journal editors always are indicating the impact factor on their cover page of their journal saying, oh, we are ranking now second in this field. Okay, is it really second, is it first? I do not know. It depends on statistics, of course. Oh, and that's very important. So regression analysis is very, very popular in bibliometrics. is does not imply causality. That's very, very important. So I have seen very bad examples where that was confused. There was a correlation, but it's not a causality. For instance, if you look at download statistics and citations, there's a strong correlation. But it's not so that downloads imply citations, or vice versa. There is certainly something in between the two. It's actually the two ways. So, of course, if you would like to cite something, you have to read it first, and probably you download the papers first. But also the other thing, highly cited papers are highlighted because they are highly cited. Huh? So there's a correlation, but by no means it's a clear causality. We have made a very interesting example just to show that even mean values and shares are normally distributed, although the distribution, citation distribution itself is skewed. And we have just drawn random samples from Belgium, all the same sample size, and we have calculated means and shares. And as you can see, the means and the shares are really normally distributed around the joint means and shares of the Belgian population. You can show it. So it's so, right? So the sample size was around 100, so it's nice people. It was just an experiment. And so what you have is certain tolerance, you have a confidence level for all these statistics in order to decide if deviation of two indicators from each other is significant or not. And you can even apply it to predictive people metrics. So normally you know it depends on the sample size, I mean the confidence interval. But if you would like to apply it to make predictions, then it's more complex. It depends on the sample size, of course, but it also depends on the observation period. So it makes a difference if you observe citation rates for 3 years or for 10 years and then predict. So the longer you observe, the more reliable. And on the other hand, prediction period is reversely proportional to the reliability. So if you use a 5-year observation period and you would like to predict 3 years is more reliable than you predict 15 years. Huh? That's also clear. So you have to keep this in mind. And of course, prediction means always future citation rates for a set of data, not for individual contribution and not for individual order. That's important. And here's something we discussed in the morning. It's actually statistical reliability in the ranking. So I'm a bit against ranking because ranking is always means always a projection on this right line to force linearity, where it is very often not the case. So research is not a linear issue. But even if you make this projection like that, you have your statistics and around this is the confidence interval and you have an overlap of confidence intervals. And here you can see these eight dots can be grouped into three classes and these are simply not significantly different from each other. But these three classes are distinct, okay? Disjoint. So just to give an example. And this also leads to the following consideration. So is again stepping away from this linear model to more a complex model, multi-dimensional model, and not using linear indicators that can always be ranked, but use performance classes, so to speak. That provides a more complex picture. And of course, there are also some other things in the background. There are some outliers and extreme values that already have distorted even mean values of an institute. I just want to mention the example by Waldman et al. 2012. It's actually a paper, I will show it, by University of Göttingen, and that has distorted the ranking of the university, actually. So the question is, how should we deal with outstanding papers? So we see that outstanding papers, outstanding citation rates are not in line what we can derive from the distribution of all the others. It's only one person or even less of the complete paper set in the distribution, but this is not in line with what we can observe on the basis of all the rest, the 99 of persons of papers in this system. Of course, we need a solution that also integrates the outstanding performance, because that's interesting. We cannot say, oh, just remove it. I do not would not like to hear from my dean to say, yeah, Wolfgang, this is a highly cited paper. It's the statistics of our faculty. Please remove it from your CV. So that's not okay. We cannot demand it. It is outstanding performance. Nobody would like that. And we have to integrate it into the system. Okay. So what can be done? What is this desired properties of the solution? Is it parameter free? Model, of course. We would not like to estimate a parameter, because then again we have the problem with statistics. It should be able to apply it within a particular field, but also for a combination of fields, because many institutes, many departments are multidisciplinary. Even scientists provide interdisciplinary results. It should be fit for application at different levels of aggregation, macro, meso, and micro level. And of course, it should replace the conception of linearly structured indicators by performance profiles. And this is a paper that's the citation rate is September 2014. That's a paper. It's actually a kind of software review. And at that time, it has been cited 7,623 times. This morning, it was already more than 44,000 citations to one individual paper. Of course, you might imagine, if you calculate a mean and average, this is distorting even the statistic of a complete university. If you have one or two papers of this, it's done. So, but of course, it's important to, you cannot tell Schellig and his colleagues to remove these papers from statistics. It's there, it's cited, of course, you have to cope with that. So what you can do, you have to develop something that can be considered an extension of the classical bibliometrics. So one alternative to the linear bibliometrics is the reduction of the distribution to a certain set of performance classes. So then the outliers, like this paper, becomes just a member of a performance class, probably the highest class, but it's just one of several highly cited papers. But the absolute number does not appear in the statistics anymore. It's just among those. So one model was suggested by Rudinsdorf et al. In 2011. They used six performance classes based on percentiles, six actually. And there's one thing or two issues with performance classes based on percentiles. On one hand, the percentiles are arbitrary. You have to decide how and what the percentiles are. For instance, 5%, 10%, 25%, and so on. So that's arbitrary. Why 5%? Why not 4.5%? That's, of course, have to be explained. Of course, you can say that's because of NSF is using 5%, or you can say because of experience, so far so good. But there's another issue, the question of ties, of course, because you have a percentage, and there are a lot of papers that have the same amount, the same amount of citations, and you have to decide which has to be assigned to which class, then having the same amount of citations received. So this is a bit, it takes against this kind of classes of use of percentiles. So another way is what we have introduced already in the 80s. It has not been used in the 80s, but now it has been used, because in the 80s it was quite difficult to calculate that. As I told you, we worked on this tape version of SCI database, but nowadays everybody can do it on the laptop, but even on the PC. Using the Web of Science online version is a characteristic scores and scales. So what we actually do, we take a population, we determine the mean value, we drop everything below the mean value, we recalculate the mean value of the rest. We do that again and again until we have received, for instance, 3 or whatever we would like to have scores, mean values. And these mean values define class. So that's it. I'm sorry, that's the visualization of this process. So here we have the mean value, first mean value, which is actually the mean value, the classical average of the citation average of the population. Then we recalculated, and of course these scores we find for classes, and if we stop it at 3, and usually we do that, and that means if we have the first class before fully cited, fairly cited, and automatically being outstandingly cited, so we have 4 classes then. And of course, if we just mention in passing, if we decide to stop it immediately at k equal to 1, we have the classical equilibrium matrix with an average below and higher than that. Okay, so it's a kind of extension. And this happens if we apply it, for instance, to 2 publication years with a different citation window, and you see the classes are quite stable. So we have about 2.45% in the highest class, then about 6.4% in the second class, about 21.5% in the fair class, and in the pro class we have about 69 to 70%. It's quite stable. And this is a typical application at the middle level. And you also see, we have the national, it's a bit lighter than the rest, and you can compare classes. It's not a ranking. You see sometimes you have a higher share of highly cited, you have a higher share of moderate cited, along with a higher share of highly cited, and so on. You have different options. And you see also that, for instance, in Switzerland, we found an institute that is below the national standard, so to speak. And we also find here a technical university in Scandinavia that has a better profile than the medical university in Scandinavia. Both are very famous. And you see, normally, it was mentioned that different subjects have different citation practices and standards. So this is also a nice kind of normalization. You really can combine now a multidisciplinary and the technical university in terms of profiles, but it's not a linear ranking anymore. You have to have a look at all the classes. So this is the moderate class, and the remarkable, that's the highest class, and the rest up to 100% is a pure class that is not, that's a supplement here. And you find 4 types, and notably, if you apply that to the lowest level, to individual scientists, you have different types of profiles. For instance, type 3 means everything is in line with the reference standard. You have at the national standard, you have at the National Corporation for Institutions, you have mostly type 2 and type 4. That means poor, so a higher share in the poorest class and lower share in the highest class. Go with each other and the other way around, but at the individual level you have all kind of polarization. For instance, you find scientists that have a lot of poorly cited papers, but also a lot of highly cited papers, or less poorly cited papers, but also less highly cited papers, and the highest share of their papers is mainstream, so to speak. You can have a closer look at their citation their research performance by means of citation. It's not a quality, it's different profile, and this gives a more differentiated picture of what they are doing and how they are cited. Just mention in passing, you can use this model also to normalize, for instance, impact measures of journals or other impact, because I have shown that was the example of the Belgian universities, that mean citation rates are normally distributed if the sample size is sufficiently large, and you can normalize it by using these scores here, and it becomes a normalized, not a standard normalized Gaussian distribution, because it's not the mean is not at 0, but the scale factor is normalized, so it has a standard deviation that is normalized, and you see how powerful this is. I have collected 2 samples or populations, actually, it's biochemistry, biophysics, molecular biology, which has a high citation standard in general, and applied mathematics, which has a low one. Then I looked at papers published in 1980 and have calculated citation for a citation window of 21 years. And I have done the same for 2006 and applied a citation window of 3 years. to see that this form Peter Spring of B3 in the Kalkin scores and scales is around 200 for biochemistry on the basis on 21-year citation window. In mathematics, the other extreme for three-year citation window for papers published in 2006 is just 5. It's about 2 orders of magnitude. But if you normalize it, everything comes down to about 3.5. It's not quite the same value, but it's already comparable. So that means more or less you have a joint standard. That does not mean you should compare mathematical papers with biochemistry papers. It just means if you have a statistics based on that normalized statistics, you have an impression already how to interpret it, independently of the subject. Huh? So that's the advantage. Now, this, we have to stop at this. I just wanted to say it comes a bit more complicated if you use network indicators because then even new members. So you mentioned the SNP indicator and also the other indicators we have, like CIMAGO journal ranking, which also consider not only the citations by others, but also who is citing. What the standard of the journal that is citing you. And this is, of course, changing if new members are joining the network. And that means if new members are joining the network, they have not direct influence on your paper or your performance, but indirectly they do have. So nothing is, at the moment, additive anymore, is, so to speak, consistent anymore. So if you have two things, you compare with each other, if you add things, the relationship between the two things might change by the other properties of the other members of the network. And I think we can use the eigenfactor, CIMAGO journal rank for that as an example. And this is something I have to leave out now. It's 12 o'clock and I think we have to go out, but we can discuss it later maybe. Okay, thank you very much.